Do you want to make a full arcade game from start to finish? Have you tried GameMaker Studio 2? In today's video, we'll show you how to build an Asteroids-style game in GameMaker Studio 2. By the end of this tutorial, you will have a fully playable game. Become familiar with the sprites, objects, rooms, events, action blocks, and even some GameMaker language. Here's a sneak peek at what you'll end up with. We'll walk you through the whole process, step by step. These are the same steps that we've seen taught in post-secondary game design schools. We are Ask Gamedev, aka the Officers of Optimization, aka Polygon in 60 Seconds, aka the Pillsbury Godot Boys. And this is how to make an Asteroid-style game in GameMaker Studio 2 in 12 steps. Welcome back. If you're new to Ask Gamedev, we make videos to help you learn about the games industry so that you can elevate your games and inspire others. If you're on a game dev journey, consider subscribing. We'd love to help you along the way. So let's get right into it. If you don't have GameMaker 2 installed, head on over to yoyogames.com/get and look for an option that suits your needs. It's also worth noting that you'll be able to complete this whole tutorial using just the trial. Once you're ready to go, fire it up and start a new drag and drop project. Step 1, frame rate. Before we lay down any freshly authored game code, the first thing we want to do is set the game to 60 frames per second. This will make our game look silky smooth. Expand the options menu in the right-hand side and then open main. Enter 60 game frames per second. Click apply, then OK. Step 2, creating the player. Let's set up the player. The first thing we need to do is add a sprite. Right-click on sprites and click create sprite. Name it player sprite. Now import your images. As you can see, our player sprite will consist of three images. Set the speed to 5 frames per second. Set the origin to the middle center of the sprite. And finally, set the collision mask type to precise. This is for the asteroid collision. And close the window. So we have the player sprite, but to be able to interact with it, we have to make an object. Objects in GameMaker are what get added to a room or level. Right-click on Objects and click Create Object. Name it Player. Do you see where it says No Sprite? This is where the sprite that we just worked on comes in. Click on it. Then select Player Sprite and save. Step 3. Creating the level. Alright, now it's time to set up the level. GameMaker calls these rooms. Expand Rooms, and you'll see there's already a default room, Room 0, waiting for us. Double-click on it to open it. Check out the Layers panel on the left side. This determines which objects will draw in front of which. Let's make a few layers for our objects. Order them so that the player is on top and the asteroids are on the bottom. Now select the player layer. Then drag the player object to your room. Test it out. We can't do anything yet, but at least we know it's working. Step 4. Adding controls and movement. Now let's get some movement. We need the ship to rotate and move when the player presses the arrow keys on the keyboard. To add keyboard input, we have to introduce events. Double-click on the player object and click the Add Event button in the Events box. Look for Key Down, then click Left. A new window will open. We want the ship to rotate, so search for Rotation in the toolbox search. There it is. Set the angle to 4, and make sure the Relative box is checked. Relative basically means add to the current angle. Repeat the same steps but for the right key. The only difference this time though is that you're setting the angle to -4. Now for some forward movement. Add an event for key down on the up key. Brace yourself for this one. We will be using GameMaker language. To do this, right click on key down dash up in the events box and click convert to GML. You might want to pause the video here and copy the code. This code is what will give the ship the classic Asteroids-esque forward movement. Lastly, we need to add the player wrapping around the screen. For this, we'll need to add a step event. A step event is basically an event that is constantly running. Search for wrap under the toolbox. There it is, wrap around room. For the margin, enter sprite height divided by 2. This is so the ship is still able to go midway through the edge of the screen instead of just the edge. Test it out. Now you can steer, accelerate forward, and can wrap around the screen. One thing you might notice is that the ship doesn't really stop. Let's fix that. Add a create event. This event gets called at the very beginning, when the player object is first created. Look for friction, and set the friction to 0.01. This will make the player slowly come to a stop if there is no up input. Step 5. Adding invincibility. While we're here, let's tackle something else. When the player is first created, they need to be invincible for 3 seconds. This is so that if they spawn on top of an asteroid, they have 3 seconds to get to safety. Let's add that now. Look for assign variable and add it. We'll name the variable invincible and set it to 1. This will allow us to indicate if the player is invincible or not. Having a value of 1 means the player is invincible, and any other value means not invincible. We only want the player to be invincible for 3 seconds, so we need to set up a timer to change this variable to 0 after the 3 seconds are up. Add a set alarm countdown action. Set the alarm countdown to 180 frames. This is the same as 3 multiplied by the room speed. Now we have to add one more event. This event will contain what happens when that alarm is triggered. Create an event for alarm 0. Add an assign variable action, and make it so the invincible variable changes to 0. Now, add another one for the image speed variable, changing its variable to 0. This will stop the flashing of the ship. Finally, add a third one to set the image index variable to 0. This will select the first frame of the ship. Test it out. The blinking stops after 3 seconds. Step 6. Creating the bullet. Now that we have a fully functioning ship, it's time for bullets. Before we connect the bullets to the ship, we first have to work on the bullet's sprite and movement. Create a new sprite for the bullet. Import your bullet image, set the origin to middle center, and save. Now, create a bullet object. Assign bullet sprite as its sprite, and now we have to add an event. We want the bullet to be destroyed if it leaves the screen, so we have to add this behavior. Click Add Event, then go to Other, and click Outside Room. Add Destroy Instance. Click the triangle to check out the options of what to destroy. As you can see, it's on self by default, which is what we want. Click Save. Step 7. Adding shoot controls. All right, we have our bullet object. Let's give the player the ability to shoot these. Go back to the player object and add another event. Key press dash space, because we want the ship to fire a bullet when the player presses the spacebar. We're using key press instead of key down because we only want the event to trigger once per key press. Add a create instance action. For the object, we want to create a bullet object. Set X and Y to 0, and have them both be relative. This means the bullet will spawn where the player is. Enter bullets for the layer so that the bullet appears underneath the ship. The target box is intended for a variable that we create. Call it new bullet. We'll make it temporary as we won't need this variable after the event has run. Now we need to set the direction. Add the set direction action. Expand it and enter new bullet in the expression field. This is the new temp variable that was just created. If we don't do this, it will run on self, which is the player object. Set the direction to the player's current angle. We can access the player's current angle by entering the object. In this case, player, a dot, and image angle, which is a variable built into GameMaker. And finally, add a set speed action. Run this node on our new bullet variable as well and set it to 15. Test it out. You can now shoot bullets. Step 8, creating asteroid sprites. Now that moving and shooting is covered, let's get into obstacles. Let's make the large and small asteroid sprites. Create a sprite for the large asteroid. We'll go with these 3 frames, but set the animation to 0. We don't want it to animate, but we will be using these frames to randomly pick an asteroid design so that they don't all look the same. Set a middle center origin, then expand the collision mask section. We will be using a custom collision mask. For mode, select manual, then rectangle for type. Drag the corners in a bit. We're making the collision box a little smaller so that the player won't get upset if they barely touch the asteroid. Having hitboxes that are smaller than the actual sprite is very common in games. Repeat this process for the small asteroid sprite. Step 9, creating the large asteroid object. All right, let's turn it into an object. Create the large asteroid object. Add a create event. Again, this means that whatever actions we add will happen when the large asteroid is created. When it's created, we want everything about it to feel random. Its speed, rotation, direction, and how it looks. So let's start making it feel random. Add a set instance rotation action. For the angle, enter the function random range 0, 360. This means it will pick an angle between 0 and 360 degrees. Add a set direction variable action. You can enter the same function as above. Add a set speed action. This time we can use the same function, but because we want a smaller range, let's change the parameters to 0.5 to 2.5. And finally, we need to pick a random asteroid design. For the sprite, we have three designs, each with their own unique image index, starting at 0. Add the assign variable action, and enter image index as the variable that we are modifying. Because we have three frames to choose from, 0, 1, and 2, we will set our random range parameters to 0 and 2. We will also use the function iRandomRange instead, so that it chooses a full integer. And now, just one more event. We need to add a step event where we add the wraparound room action, just like the ship. Step 10, creating the small asteroid object. Now let's make the small asteroid object. Because they have similar behaviors, the small asteroid should pretty much have the same events as the large asteroid. Now, we don't want to have to enter all of those events and actions again. That would be tedious. Thankfully, GameMaker has us covered. Click on Parent in the object box and select the large asteroid. Voila! The large asteroid is now the parent object to the small asteroid. This means that all of the events and actions that we just created for the large asteroid will now apply to the small asteroid. If we edit the large asteroid events and actions, they'll change here as well. Now that we have both asteroid objects acting like we want them to, let's put in what happens when the large asteroid collides with a bullet. Head back to the large asteroid object and add a collision event with the bullet object. We want to spawn three small asteroids, so before we enter a create action, let's add a repeat action and enter three times. Now we want to nest a create instance action under this. Be very careful how you place this node. It must be linked as shown. Create a small asteroid at 0, 0, relative to self, which in this case is the large asteroid, in the asteroids layer. Finally, add two destroy instance actions. Make sure they're not nested under the repeat action. For the first one, apply it to other. This will destroy the bullet. And for the next one, apply it to self. This will destroy the large asteroid. Test it. As you can see, because the small asteroid inherited this event, it too is spawning asteroids when it collides with a bullet. At this rate, we'll have infinite asteroids. Change this. Go back to the small asteroid. Right-click on the bullet collision event and click Override Event. This will override the collision event we inherited from our parent. Meaning for the small asteroid object, the parent event won't run. What we enter here will run instead. Don't spawn any more asteroids, just destroy self and other. That will do the trick. And to finish the demo off, we just have to add one more thing. Never forget the ask rule. Asteroids should kill. We need to create the player's death sequence and animation. Step 11, creating the player death object. Create a new sprite for the player's death state. As you can see, it's just a straight line. We'll be multiplying it later. Create a player death object using that sprite. Add a create event. Add a set speed action and set it to 3. Now add a step event. Add a set instance rotation action and set the angle to 1 relative. Don't forget to add an outside room event to destroy the instance when it leaves the screen. Step 12, tying everything together. Now let's tie it all together. We need to create what happens when the player collides with an asteroid. Remember in step 5 when we added invincibility? Well, now let's make it actually work. Head back to the large asteroid object and add a collision event. Select player. Add an if expression. We only want to kill the player if its invincibility variable is set to 0. If you recall, the player will always be created with an invincibility variable of 1. Then, because of the chain of actions that we created, the invincibility variable will change to 0 precisely 3 seconds later. So, if the variable is still set to 1, this action will be ignored. If it's 0 though, the player will die. Let's add the actions for that. We want it to look like the player exploded. Because the player is essentially a triangle, all we have to do is spawn 3 lines shooting in different directions. That's why our player death sprite is a single line. Add a for loop, select the temp box, and change the condition to I less than 3, as we only need this to loop through 3 times. Basically, whatever actions we add below will happen, and each time they happen, the loop restarts. Whenever the loop restarts, it will add 1 to the variable, in this case, I. This loop will keep on repeating as long as I is less than 3. Add a create instance action. Make sure it's nested within for loop. Select player death for the object. Set the coordinates to 0, 0 relative, the layer to player, and create a temporary variable called dead player. Now, add a set direction variable action. Apply it to the temporary variable dead player that we just created. For the direction, enter I multiplied by 120. The I here refers to the I variable that we initialized in the for loop above. I will be 0 on the first loop, 1 on the second loop, and 2 on the third loop. So, if we multiply I by 120 each time, we'll get the angles 0, 120, and 240. Now, let's add what happens when the loop stops. First, we need to destroy the player object, which is other in this collision. Then, we need to create a new player in the center of the room so that the player can play again. For the coordinates, all we need to do to find the center is take the room width and room height and divide them by 2. Test it out. You now have a fully functional Asteroid-style game. Give it a shot and let us know how you did. What other features would you like to see us make? Let us know in the comments. And before we leave you this week, let's take a look at the Ask Gamedev community member Game of the Week. This week's game comes from Kigades, who shared their game on our Discord server, Solaroids. Solaroids is a great choice for this week as it takes the mechanics of Asteroids, the power-ups of R-Type, the space of a mini MMO, and amps it all up with the intensity of a shmup. It's also a great showcase of how far you can take an Asteroids type of game. It's available now on Steam. If you like our tutorials and are interested in learning about another engine, Construct 3, you can check out our other tutorials here. Thanks for watching. We are Ask Gamedev, and we make game development videos on how to elevate your games and inspire others. What do you want to learn how to make in GameMaker 2? Let us know in the comments. We publish new content every week, so consider subscribing and hit the bell below to be notified as soon as a new video is available.